You have to give us a little time. She had to use my phone. So, you know, it's different. This is a time of worship songs. So those who are worshipers, feel free to worship during this song. Thank you, Jesus. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the former things have passed away. And the one seated on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." Janice Marie Donnelly was born July 27, 1956. And went to be with Jesus October 30th, 2021. She was the youngest of three siblings and the only girl. She grew up in Wheat Ridge, Colorado. She married the love of her life, Gary Donnelly, on June 27th, 1981, and became the mother of three beautiful daughters. Janice and Gary were together and married for 38 years before he went to heaven. 2013. She had still held on to his beautiful love poems through the years as a great reminder of that love. Janice owned a health food store with her mother Dorothy for nearly 30 years, one of the first pioneering health food stores of the time, located right along 16th Street before it was built and became as we know it today. She grew in great knowledge about homeopathic and herbal remedies, even as years passed, you could highlight an issue you were having, and she would know what would help to aid you naturally. She was an entrepreneur in her own right and paved the way in many avenues, be it Park Lane Jewelry, Avon, or Mary Kay. She had talent and many skills. She knew shorthand, and she continued to use it constantly through the years. She would take pictures of newborn babies in North Suburban and give them to the mothers. She also took on special needs and personal in-home caretaking for the elderly. It made her so grateful to help others through the years before going on into early retirement due to health issues. She always had a caring, compassionate heart for others. She came to Jesus at a young age and walked with him for over 50 years. She was on multiple prayer teams and healing ministries. She became an ordained minister within that time. She continued to pave the way of her grandpa and father as an evangelist to proclaim the gospel of truth. In the display of her life, her words were always filled with grace and love. She always had a listening ear and a heart. Pray for others in need. She loved flowers, and they covered her house, roses being her favorite. She was an animal lover, and that too was seen with the many animals in their home through the years. She had a pet store at one time that both she and Rachel managed. She had a child's heart and loved collecting fun little trinkets. She especially loved teddy bears of all kinds. She loved to dance, and that was seen clearly through the years by so many. She had a fun sense of humor, and she loved to laugh. Both Gary and Rachel kept her entertained through the years doing off-the-wall things. It brought her great joy to see Rachel grow up through the years. She is the oldest and only surviving daughter. Janice prayed for Rachel for many years to come to Jesus. And in 2012, Rachel devoted her life to Christ. They became very close from then till now. Just a year later, they would lose Gary and need one another even more. Janice was the best example of life devoted to walking with Jesus that Rachel could have ever had. Janice displayed his love beautifully, and it made Rachel desire to grow more into the deep love and devotion of the Creator of heaven and earth.
She and Rachel did everything together. On a whim, they would go on adventures to mountain towns, to the hot springs. They loved swimming at the rec center, painting, and doing crafts. They worshiped Jesus together, which was the best of all. Janice fought the good fight of faith through many health issues that tried to plague her, and she always trusted Jesus. Her cousin, Olga, was there for her multiple times each week, devoting her time daily to sacrifice for Janice's needs and to be a support over the years. They had a great bond as children, and that bond grew them even closer before Janice would go to heaven. Janice now rests in Jesus' loving arms and can now be reunited with her husband and two beautiful daughters. We will remember Janice as a gracious, kind, and devoted, loving, and compassionate wife, mother, daughter, and wonderful friend. Janice leaves behind her daughter Rachel, brothers Randy and Denny, cousins, and extended family. Reading from Matthew 5, 3 through 10. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Brooklyn, I believe you have some time to come up. And if I can just encourage everyone, if you hold the mic on your chin, that way everyone can hear you. If you put it out like this, pretty soon no one will know what you're saying, which is what most of you do. So I'm just giving a little help with how to hold the mic. Okay.
Thank you.
I've been so blessed to have Janice for a friend for, I think, about 17 years. And we have worshiped in different settings together. We've warred, prayed, and warred for this country and for loved ones over the years, again, in different settings. And we also had some pretty fun adventures together too, even in the midst of hard times. I was recalling with my husband the other day how it was in the beginning when she was first diagnosed. In fact, I think I took her to the appointment where she found out that she had breast cancer. But I had just gotten a convertible. I'd never had a convertible. It was just used, you know, with cute little convertible. And I was going to take her to the appointment in that. So we had to go quite a ways. Doesn't matter where it was, but we were on a highway where the speed limit was 80. So we got the top down. We are racing down this highway doing 80. And we're cracking up and we grab hands like we both thought of that silly movie. It's a terrible movie, yeah. Thelma and Louise. So we're holding hands up in the air like this. We're going 80 after, you know, and just having the time of our lives. And ever since then, that's been our nicknames for each other. So she picked Louise, and I got stuck with Thelma. One scripture that really came into my heart so strongly regarding Janice is in John 12, where it talks about how a grain of seed falls into the ground. It has to fall into the ground in order to spring up in newness of life. And, you know, that definitely was our Yeshua, our Jesus, right? He gave us all eternal life by allowing himself to suffer and the seed to be sown into the ground. But I just know that God causes all things to work together for good. And I'm not sure how exactly he'll do this, but I know that Janice, her life was a testimony of his grace and his love, his is kindness, is patience, is forgiveness and forbearance. Those of you who know, you all know Janice, you know what a precious heart, what a dear soul, what a tender, devoted woman of God. And she touched my life in so many ways. I remember when she would come to our home, my husband and I would celebrate all of the Hebrew feasts, because Yeshua is reflected in those feasts. And they're just so rich and powerful. She was so hungry to learn more about that, to participate in that. So she would come and like at the Feast of Tabernacles, and we'd be out there in our little makeshift tabernacle tent, our temporary dwelling, you know, with a fire going and worship and with instruments and voices, just worshiping the Lord. I just treasure these memories. And I treasure especially all the times we hunkered down in prayer. And we saw results. Janice had great faith, big faith. So in the last, I'd say at least maybe 6 months now of her life, I began to come over, and the Lord told me, I want you to come close to her right now. So I would come and visit one or two times a week, and we would laugh and cry together and pray and worship. But something I want to tell you about those times, because this is where the rubber meets the road, okay? I don't know about you, but not everyone is comfortable visiting people who are suffering from a sickness. And it's understandable, right? Because we don't know what to say. What do I say? And even I myself, in preparation for going over, I would go, oh Lord, I would have to go through something before I got there. I'm like, Lord, you said you promised you would pour out your spirit on all flesh before Yeshua's return. You know, you said that your glory would cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. And I would entreat the Lord, can it be now? If not now, when? If not Janice, who? That was such a struggle for me, because I'm going, what do I say? And that's what everyone would think, right? Before you're going to go see someone that you see slowly seems to be fading away from an affliction. What do we say? And the Lord said, I just want you to be real with her. Meet her right where she's at. So I would come over, and we would just go there every single time. We would go there. We would experience the anger of that which we could not understand. We would weep over the disappointment. We would reason together and just come full circle. And that was the thing I told her. I said, here's the important thing, is that we always come full circle. And what we came full circle, see, because it's okay to say how you feel, that you're mad, that you're sad, that you don't get this, where are you, God? He can take it, he's our papa. He can take it, but his ways are higher than ours, aren't they? So the way we become full circle is to always conclude with this, no matter how long or short a time we took to get there. There were two things we know, if we don't know anything else. God is good, and God is love. So we conclude every time like that, and we say everything else goes on the altar of his love. Everything we don't understand, that's where we put it. Because bottom line, God is good and God is love. I wanted to read a prophetic word. It didn't come through me, but another blessed soul. But because I know Janice, and you all do too, and how much she cared that everyone would come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua Messiah, and feel and know him intimately and have an intimate journey with him, I know that she would love it, that these words would go forth. And before I read it, I want to say this too. When I first came into this room, I was with Rachel. Came up here and she said, let's pray. So we started praying. And I saw the heavens open. And for those of you who don't know, I study Hebrew. I've been studying the culture, the history, the language for quite some time now, at least 15 years. And what I've come to learn is that the true Sabbath actually is at sundown on Friday and goes through to sundown on Saturday. So whenever I would visit Janice, we would talk about that and how the portal of heaven was open, between heaven and earth was open in a special way. Well, she went home during a Sabbath, during a Shabbat, on the 30th of October. The portal was open between heaven and earth, and it's open here again today. But as we prayed, I saw a rainbow of butterflies come down from heaven, dispersed all about. You know how much Janice loves butterflies. Then I noticed this rainbow painting up here. Where? Yeah, here it is. Yeah. That's right, that portal to heaven. This is so glorious. The forever love of the Father has transported you into the realms of the everlasting arms. Today, the Holy Spirit showed me that there are many feeling unloved and forsaken. There are many who feel God has forgotten about them, or his presence has departed from them. There have been many false shepherds who have told you that God no longer fellowships with you because of something you've done. Know this, child of God. When Jesus became your Savior, the Father belongs to you and you to him. Our God is a faithful God. It is impossible for him to lie. He remains faithful even when we are unfaithful. He loved us before the foundations of the world. His love is not based on your actions. It is by grace that you are saved. Forever you are his. There is a realm in the Spirit where he will show you who you are in him. It is the realm of his everlasting arms. As you rest here, he will refill you and refresh you by his Spirit. It is Holy Spirit CPR in the arms of Jesus. Allow the Spirit to take you there today. And I hear him saying to you, come to me, weary one. Rest in my everlasting arms. Enter the rest of the weary. I will never withdraw the arms of protection from around you. Do not let the enemy deceive you, my child. I have promised to never leave. Thank you. The devil attempts to change your perception and your perspective. He is crafty, beloved. He is sly and conniving, but he is a liar and the father of it. Keep your eyes upon Yeshua, your Savior. I am not like an earthly parent whose love is sometimes based on performance and obedience. The work of the cross forever bound us together in grace. It is never your works which find you in favor, but I have bestowed my favor upon you forever because you are mine. The arms of love will never let you go, though you may sometimes struggle. My all-encompassing power will never let you fall. Think on this, beloved. Your Savior went to the cross, died a torturous death, and never doubted that the love of the Father would raise him up from the dead. It is this same love which never gives up on you, dear one. As he is, so are you in this world. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are one, and so are we, my child. I am in you, and you are in me. Does not my word confirm this? For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom you cry out, Abba, Papa, Father. No longer feel unwanted, my child. No longer feel that you are forsaken and alone. No longer feel unlovable. I crown you with glory and honor. I have clothed you in my robe of righteousness, the garments of salvation. You are a royal child of the King. You are not lost, little lamb of mine, but you are found. I have transported you from the kingdom of darkness into my marvelous light. I am the only father who bends down to rescue you. With joy I endured the cross to bring you unto me forever. All the darkness shall flee as I open your eyes to see from my perspective. The light of my face shines upon you always. You have captured my heart forever, my child. See the sun shining. My child, rise up and come away. Let go of your own ways and thoughts of hopelessness, and let me show you that you are seated with me in the heavenly realms. Sighing and sorrow shall flee away in my presence. In my presence is fullness of joy, and at my right hand pleasures forevermore. Your beloved calls to you, arise, my darling. Come away with me, my beautiful one. Janet's got to do that literally. Until the day breaks and the shadows flee away, come to my mountain of myrrh and to the hill of frankincense. You are all fair, my love, and there is not spot in you. Arise and shine, my sons and daughters, for your light has come, and the glory has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. So I just speak shalom over you all, his peace, where nothing's missing, nothing's broken, nothing's lacking. I pray that all of you, especially the family, especially Rachel, stay in the embrace of his shalom.
Oh, that was beautiful. Now, Rachel would like to have the open mic, which is if there's anyone who would like to come and just share a memory or something that Jesus has put in your heart to share, come on up and we'll let you share.
I was telling Rachel earlier that if more people knew about today and about what's been going on, this place would be packed. Oh, sorry, Chin. Okay.
Thank you for listening.
Oh, my chinny chin chin. Yeah, this place would be packed because she didn't know anyone. I can't imagine anyone ever meeting Janice and spending even 2 minutes with her and not loving her. She exudes grace and mercy at a stellar level. If a person were to do a study on grace or look it up in the dictionary, it would probably have her name right there. See Janice Donnelly. I learned a lot from her. And the word it says, I don't know the addresses, I'm not so good with addresses, except like Psalm 91 and stuff like that. But, retrieval. Okay, iron sharpens iron. I have the mind of Christ in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Iron sharpens iron. Boy, I just even heard that in the spirit right now. Two swords and sparks flying off of them. This woman imparted grace and love and joy and worship. Everywhere she went, she made deposits like that. And I remember years ago at Power Invasion, that's where I met her. We had a tiny little church up on 32nd and Perry up on the north side. Originally, the building was called Glad Tidings. Which is that church had fire. That church carried the fire of God, and that's where I met her. And like myself, she loved color so much. And that's where, I don't know if she flagged before that, but we got into flagging because that church had really beautiful flags. You saw a few people up here earlier flagging. And it's a form of worship that's just so much fun. And it's an extension of who we are as worshipers and lovers of God. And so getting to do that with her over the years was just really amazing. getting to dance and sing. This woman has, not had, you can't say had, she has, really an unusual singing voice. And her love of birds, I think, maybe played a part in that, because she could warble. she could hit notes that I don't think I've ever heard before. She had an amazing singing voice. And so I remember praying with her. That's how we got to know each other, is praying together. And her number one mandate, she would pray for anyone and anything, anytime. But her number one mandate to pray for was her family, for her daughter and her husband, Gary. That's what she always wanted to pray for her husband, Gary, and her daughter, Rachel. And so much of the core of her being poured into those prayers. She would saturate the carpet in the church with her tears and with her prayers, praying for her daughter. And it's so magnificent what God did, that the fruit of those prayers is not minuscule. They didn't just get saved, they flourished. Rachel flourished. And God did really magnificent things with Rachel just in time for the season that was coming with Gary. So that Janice had someone to stand there by her side and pour life and speak life into Gary and watch Gary be transformed by the renewing of his mind. And man, that's so wonderful. God, we just thank you so much for what you did in that family, Lord God, in this family. It's really, even the artwork, the prophecies, just everything. I'm so grateful to everything that God did, because this last few years is just getting to see the pictures of their adventures and all the places that they went. It blessed me so much. She got to see all kinds of places in Colorado and do all kinds of things, just jump off and go. And those pictures, getting to see the joy on Jan's face and Rachel's face, the pictures of the two of them together. So many pictures. It was so amazing to get to share that through Rachel's photography. It blessed me so much. I'm sure it blessed others as well that got to share in that. I was thinking about a time when we were leaving the church, when we had to move to a bigger building. And so we moved to Marilyn Hickey's old church years ago. I can't remember the name of her church, but ours was called Power Invasion. And it was by Platte River in Alameda. And boy, that place got lit. And we had been being prepared for revival for years. And it came. It came. And we got to see and hear. We saw people get up out of wheelchairs, people throw their glasses away. There was just so many miracles that happened there. Even an old soldier that had shrapnel in his leg, the shrapnel dissolved. I mean, we saw amazing things. And one of the amazing things I got to see personally, I can't remember how many times, 9 times maybe more, anointing oil, supernatural oil, would come out of Jan's hands. While we watched, it would start pooling in the palms of her hands, and her hands would just be glistening with the presence of the Lord and the Holy Spirit just pouring into her. And sometimes it had gold in it. Sometimes it had glory dust in it. That's what we call it, whatever you want to call it. But she had such a powerful healing anointing. And so many people got set free and got healed because of the anointing on her, because of her great intimacy with Yeshua. She was visiting me one time, and a friend of mine came, and I think my friend had been having headaches. I don't remember how it started, but Jen wanted to pray for her. I asked Jen to pray for her. So we were praying for my friend and found out like within the next 24 hours or 48 hours, my friend's headache got worse and she went to the hospital. Well, it turned out she had a brain aneurysm. And Jan's hands got so hot when she was laying hands on her head. And I mean, just the fire of God, this woman said, my head's getting so hot. Your hands are so hot. Well, when my friend, a few days later, she woke up and there was doctors in the room staring at her. And they said, we're so sorry, we're all staring at you. We're just not used to this. And she looked really puzzled and he said, people that have what happened to you, we don't see them. They're gone. They die. And I think within 2 days, this woman was up going up and down the stairs. Had it not been for the encounter with Jesus through Jan that day, my friend wouldn't have lived. My friend wouldn't have lived. I remember another time that we were leaving Power Invasion pretty late at night. I think we were the last ones to leave. We stepped out the door, and this may sound strange to some people, but kingdom stuff is not normal stuff. So we were leaving, and all of a sudden, this is like in the winter, all of a sudden I smelled honey really, really, really strong. Like there was just no way for that smell to be there. And then she was just being permeated with the smell of roses. And I've had that happen before. When I first came back to the Lord, that same thing happened to me. The most extraordinary, sweetest roses you could even imagine. And he was just permeating her with his presence, with that smell of roses, that fragrance. And in the spirit, she carried that. She carries that, not past tense. So many times, singing together and worshiping together at the church, being up at the front. She wasn't a person to sit and be in the pew. She wanted to be up at the front. She wanted to be close to the altar. She wanted to be close to the presence. She was a presence. Well, I'll call her like a glory hog. She's not a hog, but she wanted God. She's God greedy. God greedy. More, more, more. More, more, more of his presence. And it was reflected in every single part of her, everything that she did. And sometimes she could be sad about something and we'd be on the phone together and just in a very short time, we'd just be laughing and laughing and laughing because of the joy of the Lord. He would just turn things around so quickly. And I'm so grateful to her that she was a Bible gobbler too. She would eat the Word of God, loves the Word of God, loves the Word of God. So praying with her was so much fun, going back and forth with verses, pulling on the Lord. This has been a very puzzling time. But God, all I can say is, but God. And I thank you that there's grace and mercy because I'm puzzled. And it's okay to take those things to God and express those feelings. And not understanding, but it's like what she shared. It has to come around for a full circle. And our ways are not his ways. And I know that out of this, everything that she planted, everything that God used her to plant, those things are still going to flourish. That's not going to stop. They will go on and on and on. In Rachel, the cultivating of the years of prayers, all that time together, everything they did together, all the prophecies that they heard together, all the worship that they did together, all the laughing that they did together, just being silly, just being two wild, wacky girls together. That's never going to stop. That's just going to go on and on and on. And so, Lord, I just thank you for everything that you have done and will continue to do through this most precious woman, one of the dearest people I've ever met in my entire life, and I'm 70 years old. I'm so grateful to Father. I'm so grateful that I got to know her and spend even just a little bit of time with Rachel. And I even got to meet Gary, which was pretty magnificent. And so I'm just so grateful to God for the gift and the treasure that Rachel is, and the gift and the treasure that Jan is, because I learned so much from her. So much about tenderness and grace and mercy. And I heard Ray laugh outside earlier in the foyer, and I had to turn around for a second because I could hear the musicality of Jan's laugh when Ray laughed. And I just put in my heart for a minute because those things go on. And so just thank you. Just pray for comfort for the family and for Ray. And I know God is still doing magnificent things. And I'm so grateful for the gift of Jan, of our sweet Jenny. Amen.
Is there anyone else who would like to share? If you don't want to come up, I can just hand you the mic.
I would have never met you, man. I'm probably louder than this. But Janice Marie Therene Donovan. Janice Marie Therene Donovan. Unassuming, faithful Christian. She suffered in her life. As you mentioned, Rachel had two sisters. She suffered and her sickness. But I find souls. And the fact that God has granted her one more miracle, and that she is dwelling in the house of the Lord, living in the kingdom of God, aka heaven. And nothing prepared, so I will love, miss, and remember my little sister, Jen.
Anyone else?
Hey, I'm Danny. I was my mom's old guy. I was the ring boy at their wedding. I kind of remember I had a blue tuxedo shirt on with silver teeth. And yeah, but I didn't get to see her a lot because I've been in trouble with the law off and on for many, many years. She never judged me. She always was just laughing. I remember one time I sent her a picture with my shirt off one time, and she's like, just made a joke about it. And I apologized about it. So, it's actually funny, but I didn't mean to send her the picture. So, but Mom, I'm grateful for you and all the help. You're gonna miss her, I know, because it's been keeping you busy and keeps you going. So we're gonna have to find something else for you to keep you going. I know it's been really, really hard on you. But she's in a better place. She was fighting, and I mean, I don't know anybody in this world that just kept fighting. I was just now going over her Facebook and everything, and there's nothing complaining about anything. It's just all praise and how to find a cure, not why do I have this, not anything. It's just, it's amazing. So anyways, I'm not good at standing, but and for you, I wish we could spend more time together, and we're gonna from now on, I promise. Because I would probably be a better person had I done that, but that's all.
Hello, I'm Katie, I'm her neighbor. I've lived next door 20 years. And I just wanna say that I'm so grateful for her. I have a 10-year-old daughter back there who's close with her. She's having a really hard time with this. She taught her a lot of lessons, and I didn't hear your name, but the last gentleman that spoke was very correct when he said, when he spoke about her positivity and optimism and just being really grateful for the moments. I have never seen anyone suffer as much as she did. And it was really hard to watch. I'm thankful that she's no longer suffering, and I'm sorry for everyone's losses. These things are really hard to speak up. But again, I'm really just grateful for all of the things that she and instilled in my daughter. We don't have family, it's just her and I, and so she loves seeing her every day and learning a lot about life's lessons, why people have to go in and be in heaven. So, Rachel, God, my heart goes out to you so much. I lost my mom about 7 years ago, and so we were able to connect quite a bit, and I'm here for you always. Anybody that plans on spending time with her will see me because I'm right next door, and we're all family. She would like that. So.
Anyone else?
My name's Brielle Bryden, and she was my neighbor and my best friend. It was so hard losing.
Hello, my name is Tracy. I'm from Nissan here on Shores. I always wanted to be up close to where everything was going on. And then I met Rachel, and so I knew them on Facebook, but then there was a prophet that was in town. He was going to different churches, and I had seen them. It's like, oh my God, I know them. So it's like they were sitting way over on another side, and I was on the right side, another guy that. So it's like, I go over there and introduce myself because I've seen them on Facebook and until they start coming here. And it's like, so and I used to go over, help her with her yard sometimes. And she was very kind. She was always wanted, she was always praying for people. And she had relationships with different people here. And she was just a very kind lady. She was very missed, but she was definitely very full of love. And she just had a real nice dog too, I remember. So I'm sure it's very nice, but she did like to pray for people. She was very gentle and very kind for people. And yet she didn't complain about her health at all. There was times that she had health issues and never, she just accepted it, though this is the way it is. And
here today, and for everyone that got up and spoke. I never thought I'd be here 8 years later, losing my dad, and the reality that time is so fleeting, and we never know how much time we have with the ones we love. And so I know heaven is the reality in that, and there's eternal promises. Past the ones that we lose, that we will get to see them again. And I just want to honor Audra for the last 2 years that she's been there for Mom. They got to build a bond over these last few years, and just supporting one another. She didn't have, there was far and few in between that were there for her, like you were. And of course there was Katie that would bring us meals, and moms were me, Sherry, who would come and check up on her. I recall many years growing up where it was never a question if I could count on Mom's support and her forever love for me. It wasn't a question that she would be there for me. And I remember the countless times that she would cuddle me every morning. And I slept in their bed for many years before they tried to kick me out. But she was always good about giving tickles. Pretty much spoiling me, if I'm honest, because pretty much, being the only child, I got everything I wanted, so she was always good at that. You can tell I'm not, any of the fun games I ever wanted, I'd always get. And I managed to lose most of those. I don't know what I did with that anyways. Just throwing things around. She always allowed me to express my creativity.
creative side. And I remember I had this little business called Rings and Things. And it was just little trinkets, little things that I put together. And I would sit at the end of the street and just wait for people to come by to buy them. I don't know, that was like days and days, and of course no one really came, but she was patient to allow me to do that and would check on me and just gave me the freedom to do that. She had me sign up for Girl Scouts and was always there to help me get ready for the talent show. And I remember we were trying to get an Elvis outfit together so I could get up on stage as Elvis. And she got me a special tape player so I could rehearse all shook up countless times until I aced it in my head. So that was good. She was always patient with me. I remember I had a sandbox in the backyard, and I don't know how, but somehow I managed to bury all her spoons in that sandbox. And she was patient to dig them out. She was always full of grace with that. She was always there. It wasn't a question, you know, if I wanted to go roller skating, which I'd love to do. She would be bringing me day after day, summer after summer. Every field day, field trips, you know, she was rooting me on just to win those championship ribbons, you know. Pretty much there for every school event. And really, she was an entrepreneur in her own right, and she dedicated hours to putting together merchandise for Avon. I remember her doing that. And she won a lot of awards through that too, that she still has up on her shelves. So I always admired how dedicated she was. And I think most of her life held a passion to do things with full devotion. And even in Mary Kay, she'd get all the neighborhood kids together and they'd do facials and they'd get all dolled up. You know, and she just wanted to get dolled up for whatever reason. And so she'd bring all the neighborhood kids over and we'd all do it together, so that was fun. And she always had a way of bringing people together to feel fully supported and loved. And I think that was seen through the work she did too, where she did in-home caretaking, and she did caretaking for the special needs and the elderly for many years. And like you said, with the new mothers in the hospital, she would take the Polaroid pictures, take the first picture of the babies, and just give them to the moms. And that was her job. Yeah, that was just it. She had a lot of fun little jobs she'd do. You know, our pet store, that wasn't so fun, but that only lasted a year. That was a hard lesson, but we loved animals, you know, so that was the mentality. Selling them, not so much, but man, I'm glad that's over. And most of all, it was her devotion to God and the many hours of counseling and praying for those in need. I just know she had deeper purpose with her time and devotion in that. In going to church when I was younger, I saw just her display and passion for God and just sitting there with the Bible open, just looking at his word and just simply turning to me and smiling, you know. And she always displayed God's love so perfectly to me in those things. And so, yeah, she loved to dance. And I think that was beautiful with her ebbs and flows and the music. I mean, countless times just through the years. You know, and that made me purposeful to go up and do that for God too. You know, just as a display of my love for him. And so, as I got older, you know, that brought me to my life, to the way she displayed Jesus. And I think just that in itself is what kept me, you know, in my own darkness. I just kept looking to her, and it's like she was a beacon of light for me. That where I was at, you know, just kind of on autopilot with life, I wasn't really living. But there was something there that I was missing. And so actually that brings me full circle to now, and a life that has true meaning and purpose. And it took me two goes to actually fully dedicate my life, if you understand that. So sometimes we want to devote our lives to God, but we do it partial, half-hearted. And out of high school initially, because I was really super depressed and on a lot of drugs. There was something there though where I think I just cried out, and everyone's power came and just hit my heart. And like, I had bad anxiety, depression, OCD, I was losing it. And you know, I was trying to self-medicate, I was trying to, you know, blaze my brains out practically, smoking a bunch of weed. Anyways, none of that worked. And I remember, you know, the moment that I called out to him, it was just removed. And something lifted where I was like, okay, Jesus, you know. Jesus is, yeah, that's what I mean, so. I did walk with him for a few years. I didn't really steward my heart as best as I should have. There's things in this world that we think will fill us up, but really it's just the emptiness of needing God. And so, anyways, I got lost again, but I did get baptized right there. Yeah, that was... 2002. Anyways, it took me about 8 years to find my way back to Jesus, but that was actually the year before my dad would be getting sick. And so it was the perfect time to meet Jesus. And I know he divinely place things in my life, and see, this is where struggles happen, where we're stretched enough to come to an end of ourselves to know we need him. And so, yeah, there had been some things that just came to an end where I just knew I needed him, and it was just the perfect timing. So yeah, that brings it all together, and lost my place. I should probably not read this anyways, because but yeah, true meaning and purpose. And you know, thank God I had God in that year of my dad's suffering and struggling to transition without him. And you know, there was a place of redeeming the time with mom and having built a relationship with her, you know, where she became a best friend to me. And her. And it was intentional to see how she displayed Jesus and how I should walk. What it meant to devote your life to God, to devote, to sacrifice some of your own desires or the things that you think might fulfill you, and really seeing the way that He can bring it to real fulfillment, you know? And so there hasn't been a hole in my heart, there hasn't been emptiness of anything lacking, of something that I'm missing in life, because I know the purpose is in Him. And that's where we built our deeper foundation, me and Mom. And like I said, it was intentional to build memories and all the places we went. And I would just search them out. It was almost like, what's the next thing we can do this week, you know? And I didn't want her to feel like she was stuck at home, you know, missing Dad, and she couldn't really work because she, you know, physically was having issues. And so that was my intentionality. That was my intentionality to make memories, because I knew time was that fleeting with Dad. And if I didn't make those memories, you know, he did that with Dad too. It was like I had a good year after coming to Jesus where it was like I knew I had to make memories with him. I didn't even know I was going to get sick like that and die. Sorry. But that was God's divine grace through it. So we have to take those moments where we're going to stop, we're going to make memories with the people we really love before it's gone. And you don't want to hold on to regret. You don't want to hold on to feeling like you lived for something, but it really didn't have much purpose to it. You know, comfortability is kind of a deceitful in itself, you know. If we ain't stretched in some way in our lives, you gotta kind of ask yourself, like, you know, how do you grow anyways, right? But yeah, I'm glad she helped me grow immensely in my value. And she showed me what Jesus placed in me to grow in. And through this process of caretaking for her, you know, which wasn't short, mind you, I mean, this was years and years of just crap. It showed me what it means to lay down your life for another. It showed me how thankful I was to give up myself and to, see how she prayed me into the kingdom, and just her constant grace and constant love over me through that too. Yeah, it brought her a lot of awe to see how I grew in Jesus through this time. And we did, you know, she was pretty much, she was stuck in her bedroom for almost 2 years, practically. And I was intentional just to bring His presence in, you know. We worship Jesus together in her bed, and He met us right there. It didn't matter. You ain't got to be in the church to encounter Jesus or feel His presence or listen to His voice. You can hear Him. You can hear Him if you want to tune in. So yeah, we built that habitation of His love and His presence, and in all the heaviness and the weariness and the suffering that I witnessed for so many years with her, His love would still come in through it, and it'd lift off those burdens. out the heaviness. And it would say, you know, I still got you, you know, none of this will ever make sense right now. But, I still got you. I'm still gonna be there for you. And so, we might feel orphaned in some ways, we might feel alone, you know, there might be times where we expect family to be there. For people to be there, we hold to certain standards and there's disappointments, but you know, we're all just people, we're all trying to make it. But I know God is the standard in that He never fails me, He never forsakes me. That you know, He says I'm there for the widow, for the orphan. He's Papa God. He's the one that created you. There's the reason you find purpose is because He puts things in your heart for you to discover. And as you seek Him, he brings the answers into that for you to find your full purpose. So there's just so much written on your destiny, and that's why we feel like, you know, well, this is it, you know, this is it, you know. Then I'll get to heaven and I'll experience God's glory. But no, that's not it, because we want to experience it here for the now. And we can. And you can know deeper purpose and things that you would never think you could do. You know, there's so many things He's shown me that I never even thought I could even do, you know, painting. Playing a bass guitar, sitting here talking, which is really awkward. But it was in my uncomfortability that helped me grow. And I want to see that. I want to see that I lived a life of purpose, and even in the stretching and the loss, that it was worth living. And it was worth living outside of myself, outside of my comfortability. And knowing Him. And actually knowing the one that created me. So yeah, I'm thankful for the years we spent together. I'm glad I was intentional. She deserved it. She went through a lot. I'm glad that she's with my sisters again. You know, a lot was stolen and hindered through her life. And I have a few friends that see, you know, through the portal of heaven, and she's already been riding horses with Dad.
Wow.
Yeah. And, one friend saw her going to the fair with the whole family. Yeah. And then, what's the other thing? I can't remember. Oh, that's right. Okay, so I've been cleaning out her house. I moved into her house. I'm in this weird transitional place. God told me to pack up my stuff like a year ago, and he was like, you're going to be moving. And so, anyways, I've been getting it together, and, you know, I had to move in my stuff, so I've been getting rid of her stuff, but she had a bunch of dolls, you know, kind of like those lifelike looking dolls, and they kind of creeped me out, so I got rid of them. I was like, I gotta get rid of these dolls, man. I'm sorry. And I told her, I was like, I'm sorry, Mom. I'm gonna give these to Goodwill. Yeah. But my friend saw her intentionally, mind you, putting a doll in my mansion. So when I get to heaven. I was like, really, Mom? A creepy doll like that? And she was laughing. But she was doing it. Yeah, so she's having fun up there, you know. Heaven's a great place, and that's why I think intentional. you know, we grieve in the loss of someone, but if you embrace heaven, you know how great it is. It's a joyful thing, you know? And so I don't want to wear black. I don't want it to be heavy, even though it's emotional, because our love goes deep for people. But I wanted to bring the intentionality of heaven, which is colorful and bright, and everything is living. It's the breath of life. Everything that flows through you, the very breath that you have, you're breathing him in, right? Because you gotta think like your very being, like just how you're existing, says he's the breath of life. The fact that we're just breathing. But anyways, now I'm just winging it, which actually feels a lot less winging. I was like trying to read this over there. So you know, God's always going to meet you in those times of struggle, and he'll show you signs of reassurance. And he did this with my dad as well. He, as you can see, people see visually. You can see God will give you dreams and visions. He's gonna support you and show you things to encourage you along the process, even through your loss. And he did that with Dad. He brought a lot of blue jays and hawks, and they would perch in the trees. And I knew that the blue jay was Dad's bird. And over this last summer, we saw countless blue jays out in front of Mom's house in the trees. And so I always knew it was Dad. It was like, oh, he's just coming in and saying, hey, what's up, I do? You know, just checking in on you. And that was really apparent to me, that I was like, wow, Dad's checking in a lot. And but I knew it was also, you know, he was highlighting something with birds. Because then I started finding feathers. I found hawk feathers, and I found woodpecker feathers. And there was all different kinds of birds, even doves. There'd be like doves that were perching right up in the front of that tree. Same thing. Mm-hmm. Blue jays, you know, hawks, doves. And she was really drawn to birds. She kept wanting like little trinkets of birds or things that, you know. And so right here, I brought this. So this was a painting I purchased from a prophetic artist, and his name is Darren Canning. And I just saw a bird, and I said, well, Mom's gonna love that. And I asked him, I said, well, what's this about, you know? And so prophetic means like you hear God, you see God. You see things, I'm trying to say in a way, you see things God wants you to see, you know, he'll show you. But he saw a vision, essentially, and he saw this bird. He says it was just kind of perched on the edge of a portal, and it was the portal to heaven, and the bird represented freedom. And I didn't think of it much, you know, the significance of it at the time. But I knew that, now I know, that this represents Mom. And her ability to be freed from her suffering, you know, she was going to be able to just go into heaven and be freed from her suffering. So she was that bird. And yeah, that was one thing that he just highlighted to me. And so, yeah, that she would look up and she'd see the heavens open to bring her into the everlasting glory of his kingdom. And that she would be free from her suffering. And through this process, I just learned to lay down my life for her. And to look past circumstances to know that he still has promises for me. Because, you know, I feel alone quite a bit and uncertain. But it's not the end of the story, you know. And in life has a way of taking life out of us. And sometimes I feel like she tried as much as she could to hold on and embrace life. But it had a way of just kind of sucking her dry. And she really did fight the fight of faith, but there's so much that the mortal body can do, you know. So she's still liberated and she's freed from that suffering, which is really reassuring because it was horrible to witness. And my heart grew through it. I don't really know all of what was placed in me, but I know the compassion I see when people suffer. Even to want to pray for people that are suffering. And I've seen my own miracles in that. I've seen that, you know, at the job, you know, and you have to be intentional with that too, but there's people that are crying out. They're crying out in their suffering. It might be emotional, physical. And I've gotten the honor to pray for people and see them healed right in front of my eyes. And then I see them the next day because I got to greet them every day and check their badges because that's what I do. But there's intentionality in that, and that's purpose. That's looking outside myself and says, oh, okay. And it's amazing how God will work through you in those things because he's just sovereign. So, I guess, you know, I just pray that each one of you find your purpose in him. And I know there's times that we just, our hearts feel stirred up and kind of a, guilty or wary of those things, but true purpose will always be in Jesus, and he'll meet you right where you are. I mean, as many times as I was screwed up, that's where he met me, and it's true freedom. It's true freedom in looking past yourself and knowing him. And even though I have a lot of uncertainties, I know he's gonna bring me, like I said, into something new. Mm-hmm. And he also highlighted, in order for there to be a new beginning, there has to be an end. So there you go. And so I'm gonna just, I guess I'll close with that. I'm gonna just say a prayer right now. And if you wanna just close your eyes and if we could be intentional just to breathe, even in these last few years, it's been really weird in this world, as it is, but more so with everything that's gone on, uncertainties on many platforms, different arenas. So yeah, let's just, if you want to close your eyes, you can. But even just reflecting on your purpose, because you have purpose. And each one of you should know that. And you have value. And things have been intentional for you to be here. Because everything that he creates is with intention. It's with purpose, it's with value, it's with his divine love. So, right now, thank you right now, Holy Spirit, and I just pray that you'd come. And I just pray that you'd touch each heart that needs you right now, Jesus. And that they could really encounter your love, and it's
place of feeling you've ever fallen short, but that that he wants to just embrace you. And so I just ask right now that you just touch each heart, Lord, in the way that they need it. And even any of the heaviness and weariness through years past or through the traumas and hurts that they've gone through, but that lifts right now. And that your value and your purpose and your peace and love just falls over them right now. So I just thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And I thank you for everyone that came and honored Mom today. I'm gonna miss you, but I anticipate seeing you again.
Yes.
And I thank you that you'll be with me throughout it. And I thank you for showing me what it means to walk with Jesus and to love like Jesus. And I love you. Amen. Get in his presence. Oh yeah, sure, let's do it. Let her rip. So I did this with the YouTube videos in the background. But I think it came together well.
A time to kill, a time.